library at Littlemore, and I'm about to talk to Father Ian Carr. There's a wonderful atmosphere of peace, and it's deliciously bookish. Somehow, it does feel very Newman here. Mm-hmm. And Father, you're really, well, I don't know, a world expert on Newman.
I'm the world expert, not a world expert.
And you've been on EWTN before, and yes. While we're going to be talking about lots and lots of things about Newman, mm-hmm. The bit I'd like to ask about is that you had some active part in the two miracles that are now being used, if that's the expression I want, for his canonization. I mean, you were part of that story.
Yes, I don't know whether theologically I can say I'm the ultimate cause or EWTN is the ultimate cause. Yes, I went all that arduous journey from the Cotswolds to Birmingham, Alabama, and little did I realize the consequences of doing these. I think I did, I can't remember how many programs I did. But anyway, Jack Sullivan, the deacon in Massachusetts, who was healed for the first miracle when Newman was beatified, he was just sort of, what you call it, not surfing, you know, but
browsing TV.
And he came across EWTN and he stopped and listened, and that got him praying to Newman. And and I said, I think I said, I was asked, why hasn't Newman been beatified yet? And I said, well, because the sort of people who are interested in Newman write theses and books on Newman aren't the sort of people who do any praying. Mm. Anyway, and so we need ordinary people to pray. And anyway, Jack Sullivan started praying. But the lady in Chicago, who's now been healed, the miracle for the canonization, she also saw the program. And she wasn't at that point ill, so she didn't start praying. But she got interested in Newman. And when she did fall very ill, she started praying to Newman.
So actually, EWTN is at the cutting edge of all of this. And although you've been in Birmingham, Alabama, and we both find it funny, don't we, that there should even be another Birmingham there, only being the one in the Midlands. The whole story of Newman is so incredibly sort of English, but it's now worldwide. Mm. Do you feel that he's been claimed by a wider public, or is he yet to be claimed?
You have to remember, one has to remember that all the immigrants to the United States, none of them spoke English except the Irish. And the Irish, of course, hadn't really got any culture to bring because they'd been oppressed and persecuted by the English for so long. So I think what happened in America was that the Catholic revival, with Newman and Chesterton and Gerard Manley Hopkins and all that, and Graham Greene and even War, but particularly Newman, this was the only Catholic stuff they could find in the English language, you see, because every chaplaincy at every state university is named the Newman Center. How many students know why? But they obviously did that to show the WASPs that actually Catholics weren't just ignorant and uneducated immigrants, but they have some very great Catholics, intellectual Catholics.
And there is this idea, Newman Center, Newman Colleges, Chaplaincy. Mm. And here it is, it began really, the it of the Newman thing as a public thing began here in Oxford with the Oxford movement in this utterly vanished Britain of a Victorian era. And this very cosy library was, of course, a funny little shabby cottage, part of the stagecoach turnaround.
Had been the stables, yes, for this.
Yes. But the Oxford movement, which, of course, was the university thing that with the clergy, that was really what got Newman into the national story, the national headlines.
The Oxford movement, yes.
Yes, mm-hmm. Because he was the person at the heart of it. Tell me a bit about the Oxford movement.
Well, the Oxford movement really got going as a result of one of those great providential events in history when Newman was sacked as a tutor at Oriel because he was trying to introduce the Oxford tutorial system, very similar to what he was trying to introduce. Because before that, undergraduates were taught in classes, like in an American liberal arts college, I suppose for about 15 or 20 students. And Newman wanted the tutor to have much more personal influence. Because, of course, they were all Anglican clergymen at that time. And so he began, having been sacked, he had time to systematically read the fathers. And so, of course, he was a world authority, particularly on the Greek fathers, which is why the Orthodox are interested in Newman, because his theology is much more Greek than Latin. You see, he didn't know much. I mean, I don't know how much he knew about St. Thomas Aquinas, but he knew a great deal about St. Athanasius and St. John Chrysostom. And, of course, he recovered so many of those things that we've recovered in modern times, namely the importance of the resurrection, the incarnation, the Holy Spirit. All this he got from the Greek fathers. And so, as he said, it's Oxford made us Catholics, meaning reading the fathers.
So he turns to the fathers. And in doing so, changes the whole idea of an Anglican clergyman, what an Anglican clergyman is and so on. To me, this is what's fascinating. But by the end of the 19th century, the whole idea of an Anglican clergyman and what he might do is quite radically different from, say, Jane Austen's clergyman.
Well, that's why Newman didn't like Jane Austen's novels, because he didn't like the clergyman in them. But you have to remember, of course, Newman's interest in the fathers was he was really trying to find out what is Christianity, because he'd begun life as, I suppose, you could call a Bible Christian. You know, somebody who was simply, you know, the typical kind of Anglicanism wasn't evangelical, it wasn't high church. They went along and sang, read scripture. That was what Newman always said was. So he's brought up on that. Then he had that conversion at the age of 15 in 1816, when he fell under the influence of this evangelical schoolmaster, clergyman, who put all these Calvinist evangelical books in his hand. So for a time, he always said it wasn't a proper evangelical conversion. They didn't have a sort of born again. But certainly the Christian doctrines became real to him for the first time. And then, of course, he got was elected fellowship at Oriel, where there was the precursors of modern liberal Anglicanism. And so he, as he said, says in the Apologia, I was drifting dangerously in the direction of liberalism. So he'd moved from Bible Protestantism to evangelical Protestantism to liberal Protestantism. And so the time had come for him to, you know, well, what is Christianity? We've all got the same Bible, but we interpret it quite differently. So he began, that's why he began reading the Fathers.
So there is this direct link between John Henry Newman and the Oxford movement and all that flowed from that, especially Newman's own coming into the Catholic Church, and the events of the Second Vatican Council and its precursor, and it's all to do with rediscovering the Fathers.
Yes.
One of the things that I think was shattering for him, and even today some Protestants find it difficult to grasp, is when you read the early church and how Marian it was. And also how any Marian devotion that the church had in Newman's day and we have today is also very scripturally rooted and also very popular. Father, let's just backtrack a bit as we talk about Newman, because one of the things that he particularly loved was the presence of our Lord in the Eucharist, in the tabernacle.
Well, in the reservation.
The reservation.
In the tabernacle.
And this is something he hadn't really understood at all as an Anglican.
He didn't know anything about it, no. It's amazing to us. But of course, he'd hardly ever been in a Catholic church. Well, he went into the Assumption in Warwick Street as a boy with his father to hear some music. But apart from that, he'd never been in a Catholic church in England, as far as I know. He'd been in churches in Italy, of course, but he didn't understand what was going on, didn't realise that.
And so the glowing lamp and that sense that you get, he's here, was something that was
When he says when he's on his way to Rome, to the College of Propaganda, and he's going through Milan, he's in Milan in the late summer or early autumn, and he said, and of course it was still very hot, you wouldn't have liked it, and so the doors are all open. And he says, you know, you look and you see the lamp, you see the glitter, and now I understand what it is to be a Catholic.
And one of the things that one finds very touching is that he's a saint for the misunderstood, for the people facing difficulties with superiors.
Well, he also said he was only fit to black the shoes of the saints in heaven.
Well, I think that probably means he did have an understanding of being saintly. He is our first saint since the heroes of the Reformation era.
Yes.
But he's very much nearer to us. Although Victorian London is a very, very different city from the one we know, and Victorian Oxford, there are glimpses of the Oxford, the London, even the Birmingham that Newman knew. I mean, railways, umbrellas, cups of tea. He sort of connects with our world. What do you think about that?
Yes, and the tourism had begun. You know, he complained about the tourists up at Abbotsford, you know, poking their noses into the windows of Hope Scott, you know.
And
he said, these people coming, the cooks, you see, that was, of course, began in his time.
Cook's tours, yes. Do you think that we feel nearer to him because he is a little bit of a modern chap? I mean, even his clothes, they're very formal, but they're vaguely recognisable in a way that, oh, I don't know, a doublet and hose or a Roman robe are not. Is he near enough to us? I'm talking now culturally.
Well, it depends on what way you mean Roman. I mean, he's not remote as a writer. No. Because, I mean, who reads Pusey and Keble today? Nobody.
Nobody at all.
Do you see?
True.
So we come back to his achievements, his writings. And, I mean, he's very contemporary in that way. And and also, as I say, his use of slang. I mean, he wasn't at all, because I think we do tend to think of Victorians as rather pompous sort of people.
Yes, indeed.
But there was nothing pompous about Newman.
He also had a very strong understanding, Newman, I mean, of a freedom for the church.
Yeah.
truth is what matters, and truth imposes itself. You can't coerce people into a being.
Well, I was really struck years ago when I first read those words of Paul VI when he was beatifying Dominic Barbary, and he spoke, it was really more beatification of Newman, actually, and he spoke about this long, the most arduous journey that had been made, and Newman's great love of truth. And I remember thinking, well, what's so strange about that? But as I grow older, the older I grow, the more I realise that most people aren't really interested in the truth. They really aren't.
I think they even find the idea that you would make sacrifices for the truth. And even some Catholics are more comfortable in a way with just saying it's a tradition, it's a tribal thing I inherited. Yeah. And that way they can not really have to give their hearts to it.
No.
Whereas Newman said it was never a tribal thing. On the contrary, it cost him a great sacrifice to become a Catholic.
Yeah.
Do you think his passion for truth, even when put on his tomb, you know, out of the shadows and into the truth, is this the big thing? Is this the thing that shines through also on Vatican II, which emphasised truth and the imposition of truth on ourselves? Because it's true, I must believe it, not it's true because I ought to go along with it, be coerced into it, the government wants it.
Well, in some ways, of course, Newman was quite postmodern in the sense that he understood, that, as I was saying previously, he understood that people, we all see things differently depending on where we're coming from, you know, what baggage we have. And in that way, he's very postmodern. But of course, unlike the postmoderns, he did believe in objective truth too.
And he didn't really like the idea of any kind of something imposed on you that you then just accepted. Because truth imposes itself. You have to believe it if it's true.
Yes, you see, was Pusey driven by a desire for truth? I rather doubt it. He was driven by the desire to try and make the Church of England conform to what he understood the Fathers to be saying, which was his own interpretation, of course. Because as Newman said, he makes himself his own Pope.
Yes, that's true. And Newman also had this idea that the exercise of the mind in its struggle for truth is a noble exercise.
Yeah, and you see, Keble really was against, Keble thought you should just stay where you are. I mean, this is a strange element in Keble. I mean, that he really was interested in the truth, not in the way Newman was.
Do you think Newman's idea of understanding what is true and then, if necessary, making an enormous sacrifice for it is that what attracted people to him? I'm thinking of the young anti-Nazi Germans.
The White Rose.
They were hugely influenced by him, which seems odd, really.
It was what he said about conscience is what impressed them, wasn't it?
Yes, but it's rather profound,
yeah.
Given that they were passionately anti-Nazi, but Britain was, you know, bombing Germany and so on. So to honour this great Englishman,
sure,
rather marvellous.
Because what the girl, I can't remember her name now.
Sophie.
Yeah, she wanted to be a Catholic when she was in prison, but she was, I think of the Lutheran chaplain, impressed upon her that it would upset her. Her parents were really sufficiently upset, and you know, so she didn't actually.
But Newman could never have imagined that he would influence young Germans in an unthinkable war, and right down to people today.
Mm. So of course, she gave a copy of some German translation of some of Newman's sermons to her boyfriend, who was going on the Russian front, and he survived and came back and married the sister, didn't he?
So there's Newman even in that story, sitting there on the Russian front, reading. Isn't this a tender story?
Yeah, it's extraordinary.
Story?
Yeah.
And so, what would you say? You can't. None of us can predict the future. But do you think? Oh, I don't know. Into the 22nd century, the next century, 100 years from now, people will commemorate the 100th anniversary of Newman's canonization. Do you think he'll be influential then, or will it just be
history?
Well,
yes, I mean, the important thing, people say, are you pleased about him being canonized? Well, I am, for a number of reasons, but one reason is because he can now be declared a Doctor of the Church. Because years ago, the English bishops who'd been influenced by they were all anti-intellectual, and they had this idea from Wilfrid Ward's book that he was kind of sad and hypersensitive. They asked Rome if he could be made a doctor of the church without becoming a saint. And of course, Rome said, no, you can't be a doctor of the church without being a saint. Because doctor of the church is more than just a high-powered theologian.
Of course.
So he will now, sure, well, I don't know about this pope, but he will undoubtedly be declared a doctor of the church.
So 100 years from now,
And what I've always held and argued is that just as the Tridentine Church was the church of St. Robert Bellarmine, the post-Vatican II church is going to be the church of St. John Henry Newman. Because he did anticipate a number of the things in the council documents, of course. And we were talking, about the recovery, the ressourcement.
Of the fathers.
Yeah.
And he is seen as the father of the Second Vatican Council. So 100 years from now, people will speak of John Henry Newman, the post-Vatican II church,
yeah,
a church equipped for the modern era.
Yeah, I think so. And of course his whole emphasis is on faith and reason, which of course obviously interests Pope Benedict a great deal, as you know, because that was one of his big things, of course.
Well, it is the issue of today, with young people saying, has not science disproved faith and so on? We don't want a faith that simply sounds a nice, soppy idea. It has to answer the questions that people ask. And Newman was adept at this. And so would you think in the future, more than now or as much as now?
Well, I think more theses are written in Rome on Newman than anybody else. And one reason, of course, is he wrote in English. So Africans and Indians can read him very easily, whereas they don't know German.
And is this perhaps too part of the providence of God and an extraordinary legacy of the British Empire?
Yes, the English language, this is our the world language, yes.
That's a strange thought on which to end. Newman, the thoughtful, gentle scholar, perhaps has a longer term influence on what remains of the British Empire.
Yeah, that's an interesting point, yeah.
Yes, which is funny. And we owe that to the men that built the railways and the soldiers that defended the empire, perhaps allowed scholars today in Africa to read Newman.
I do notice that since the beatification, I think I get more inquiries, you know, and people approaching me with questions and or asking me my advice on what. But I think it's increased quite a bit since the beatification. So I think the canonization is going to. Well, the fact that Oxford University Press is reissuing my biography both in hardback and paperback, which is really rather astonishing, shows that, you know, that they are expecting a lot of interest.
And the vision of the church that was grasped at the Second Vatican Council, very evangelistic, passionate about truth, and very, very missionary, not something. That's very Newman, isn't it?
Yes, I've written about Newman and the new ecclesial movements, actually.
Yes.
And the Lumen Gentium, which is surely the central document of the council, which is almost entirely about the church. So the document where the council says what is the church? And it's very new. And of course, those first two chapters are really a marvellous example of resourcement. Because the first chapter, unlike the liberals always think that the first chapter is the people of God, it's not. It's the church's mystery. Well, that's thoroughly Eastern. And of course, Pope John called the council both for Christian unity and the renewal of the church. And those two first chapters, I think, are very important. The first chapter, because it sends a clear signal to the Orthodox, who always say we only believe in the church militant, you know, the pyramid church. And so it makes it absolutely clear the church mystery. And of course, the people of God is not the laity, as the liberals are always saying. It's all the baptized.
Yes.
And so when the council in the second chapter says, well, what builds up the people of God? It simply lists the seven sacraments. The word laity never occurs, nor the word clergy.
So it's
everyone gets the sacrament of baptism, but most people get the three sacraments of initiation, and a lot of people get married, and some people get ordained, and most people will have the sacrament of penance, and most will be anointed at some point or other in their lives.
And this is what builds up the church, and it's ecclesial movements. They were not ever lay movements.
It's very interesting. If you look at the decree on the, if you look at the decree on the laity, and you look down at the footnotes. You don't find biblical and patristic footnotes. There's only one. Well, there's no scriptural quotation because, of course, the idea of a layperson was unheard of. I mean, St. Paul says the church is apostles, evangelists, teachers, helpers. Mm. The idea of the laity was unknown to him, and so the only thing they can quote from the fathers is St. Augustine. I'm a Christian with you, but a bishop for you.
That's right. But then one of the people that is most quoted in the Catechism of the Catholic Church, a fruit of the council, is John.
No, but John Henry. He was mentioned a lot of times in the council floor, in the in the aula.
Well, thank you, Father, for a fascinating interview, sitting in Newman's library here at Littlemore. It's been lovely. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Joanna, because you're such a wonderful interviewer that I've enjoyed it very much.